last class I finished discussing about the DC to DC converters, and I briefly told you about the soft switching inverters, soft switching DC to DC converters as well. Soft switching generally is used for to reduce the switching stress, on the device. Okay, so if I use soft switching technique, it is possible to increase the switching frequency. Therefore, the size of filter components comes down. Okay, since I am doing soft switching, there are only conduction losses now. Your switching losses are practically eliminated by using a separate L and C, what is known as the resonant elements. So there is no EMI has been taken care. Since there are losses have reduced, my entire cooling requirement also has come down, but then the complexity has increased. Okay. So far we have discussed about DC to DC converters. Depending upon the power level and depending upon the voltage level, we can, or as of now we are in a position to decide on a suitable circuit topology. Okay. Basic circuit topologies we have discussed. Let us see sometime later whether we need to do some modification in the basic circuit topologies. Okay. Now we will see, given an input, given a DC voltage, and if I want to convert it to AC, what are the possible ways of doing this. Well, initially we will do the basic inverters, and maybe when you are doing the overall system integration, the modification that are generally made depending upon the power level, we will see. I said basically there are two types, current source and voltage source. I also told that the literature says that the weakest link in voltage source inverter is the electrolytic capacitor. Okay. So in order to improve the total lifespan of the inverter, I think we may have to find a solution to this electrolytic capacitor. Can we replace this by some other more reliable storage element? Okay. Still an open-ended question. Okay. Second is a current source has certain advantages here. Okay. Here the voltage is at this in the voltage source inverter, current can reverse. Current can reverse instantaneously in a capacitor. So basically, I need, but then voltage at this point cannot change. Similarly, here current cannot change instantaneously, whereas voltage across the inductor can change instantaneously. So I need to, I can't use the same type of devices in current source and voltage source. There are two different types of devices. Here it is a bidirect, the switch should be able to carry current in both direction, but it need not block the voltage in both direction. Whereas here it need not carry the current in both directions, but then it should be able to block the voltage in both directions. Okay. We started discussing about half bridge voltage source inverter, basic building block. I need total the total input voltage is VDC, but then at the output I have a square wave whose magnitude is VDC by 2 and minus VDC by 2. It is a square wave. Okay. It has its own fundamental component. Okay. It is given by 4 by pi into VDC by 2. Okay. Then I also found that though I am switching S1 and S2 are complementary, I need to turn off S1, and there has to be a finite time for which neither S1 and S2 are gated. Okay. But then even if I get S2, okay, for finite time current may not flow through it because of the load power factor. For some time current flows through D2. Okay. Now if I replace the load by an inductor, an ideal inductor, okay, how does the current waveform look like? I said I'll replace this load by an ideal inductor when S1 is on, voltage applied to the load is VDC by 2 and it remains constant for T by 2 seconds. See, I will repeat, I have connected an ideal inductor across AB, that is the load. I close S1 for T by 2 seconds. Voltage applied to the load is DC and it is equal to VDC by 2. A constant DC voltage is applied to an inductor, therefore current increases linearly, okay, provided it does not saturate. Of course, we should not allow the inductor to saturate. After T by 2 seconds, S1 is turned off and S2 is turned on. Voltage applied to the load is minus VDC by 2, remains constant for T by 2 seconds. So therefore, current decreases linearly. And at steady state, current waveform looks something like this. It is a triangular waveform. Okay. So this is T by 2, so this will be T by 4. For T by 4 duration seconds, D1 conducts, and after that S1 conducts for T1 by 4 seconds and so on. So if I see the compare the voltage and current waveform, see, this is the voltage applied to the load and this is the current flowing. Voltage applied is positive, current is negative, therefore the product, that is nothing but the power, is negative. So source is absorbing power, in other words power is flowing back to the DC link. Okay. Similarly here, voltage positive, current positive, so product is positive, source is supplying power to the load. In this zone, current positive, voltage negative, so therefore power is negative, source is absorbing power, and the remaining last T by 2 seconds, voltage negative, current negative, therefore power is positive, source is supplying power. So the average power consumed by the load is 0. It makes sense because load is an ideal inductor. Okay. So average power consumed by the inductor is 0. Okay. As of now, let us neglect the device losses as well, the so called switching and the conduction losses. I will assume that the inverter is an ideal one. So an ideal voltage source inverter feeding an ideal inductor, power, average power required or average power input is 0. Okay. So if the average power input is 0, so we can replace this battery by a capacitor, charge the capacitor once and forget about it. It will continue to work for ever. In the sense, I am neglecting the losses, there are no losses, loss system is lossless. For some time capacitor is supplying the energy, and after some time the remaining half cycle in the entire one period, capacitor receives power. So capacitor voltage will change, when it is charging capacitor voltage will increase, and when it is discharging capacitor voltage will fall. Okay. So there is going to be a ripple in the DC link voltage, fair enough, but then I do not need to have an active source. If I consider a non-ideal system, in the sense this inductor has a finite resistance which is very small, devices have finite losses, again these losses are very small compared to the kV rating. So the net losses, they are finite. So if I have a capacitor here, in order to maintain the voltage constant, I need to have some input active, power input to the DC link. Okay. So this is a very important concept that is required when we are connecting this inverter to the grid. Okay. If the inverter is feeding or supplying power to an ideal inductor, and if I consider ideal devices, so average power required is 0. Okay. If I take the non-idealities into account, active power that is required to maintain or to sustain this DC link is very small compared to the kVAr supplied by the source. Why kVAr? It is supplying reactive power or supplying an inductor. Okay, VI is kilowatts plus VAr. Okay, J VAr. So you require a delta P to sustain or to address this or to account for the losses. You require delta P to account for losses while supplying Q. Supplying Q. Okay, so this power, active power, which is maybe equal to delta P, has to come either from the AC grid, or I need to have an active source to supply this power. Okay. So if there, if I do not have the grid here, and if I connect a load and connect an ideal inductor, then I need to have some sort of a I need to have either a battery or maybe power input from, as part of the power input from solar is being utilized to address these losses. Okay. Remember, an inverter can supply any Q. Any Q in the sense, as long as it does not exceed its rating. To do that, it requires delta P. Okay. A very important result, I will just write here. Inverter requires delta P to supply Q. Okay. So in a grid feeding inverter, as of now we do not know how to connect it to the grid. Let us assume that, okay, we know how to connect the inverter to the grid. Okay. Having connected the inverter to the grid, there is no solar insulation. In the sense, in the night, grid requires reactive power support. At that time, inverter can supply Q. To supply this Q, it requires a very small amount of power. So this power can be drawn from the grid. Okay. So at night, there is power. So if there is no input from the sun, grid requires reactive power support. At that time, inverter, your existing setup or grid feeding inverter can supply Q, which can be equal to its kVA rating of the inverter. Okay. But to do that, it draws a very small amount of power from the grid, that is equal to delta P. The control loop, the control structure, we will see sometime either on Tuesday, the second half, or on Wednesday. Yeah, what are the limitations of off bridge? I said input voltage is total is VDC, but then output is VDC by 2. Output is VDC by 2. This one. And maybe only one device is conducting at a time, so maybe losses are less. Okay. Now, see here, off bridge inverter, I have actually VDC divided into two parts, but then I get VDC by 2. Okay. So has a fundamental component which is sinusoidal, which is equal to 4 by pi into VDC by 2. Now if you want a 230 volts RMS, 4 by pi into VDC by 2 is 300. So calculate what is VDC is required. Now, instead of using that, can I use full bridge inverter? See what happens in full bridge inverter? There are four devices. Okay, two are conducting at a time. S1 and S2 on. Voltage applied to the load is VDC. Turn off S1 and S2. Turn on S3, S4. Voltage applied to the load is minus VDC. Okay, but then two devices are conducting at a time. It could be an issue see, two devices are conducting at a time. If the input voltage is say around 400 volts, device drop is of the order of 2 to 2.5 volts. One device conducting or two device conducting, it may not make any difference. See, I will repeat, the input DC link is high, say is of the order of 400 volts. How did I get this magic figure 400 volts? I will tell you later. Right now, we assume that it is 400 volts. So, if it is around 400 volts, device drop could be of the order of 2 to 2.5. One device conducting or two device conducting makes, it may not make any difference. Now, instead, if I have a 12 volts solar panel or say 24 volt solar panel, VDC by 2 is going to be 12, 12 minus 2 is going to be 10. Or now 12 minus 4 is going to be 8. Or if I have a 24 volts panel, 24 minus 4 is 20, is 1 over 6, really significant, really significant. So, it depends on the input voltage. Another limitation is output voltage is a square wave. So, if I take the Fourier, if I write the Fourier series, the harmonic spectrum is going to be fundamental. If t is 20 millisecond, I have a 50 hertz supply, then I have third, fifth, seventh, ninth, all odd harmonics are present, all odd harmonics are present. So, if you require or if you want a sinusoidal supply and the harmonic content should be as low as possible, I need to do something else. I just can't allow the device to conduct for 180 degrees. See, each device is conducting for 180 degrees. Having turned on, it is maintained in that state for 180 degrees. I will repeat, having turned on, S1 and S2, they remain on for 180 degrees. So, limitation here is it has all odd harmonics. Three phase inverter, single phase we discussed. Now, let us see a three phase inverter. We require three legs of an inverter. Where is that SV? Yeah, here is it. Three legs, there are three legs of the inverter, it is an IPM. I require three such modules, and I do not know how many such devices are required, because these are 4 amperes, this is 75 amperes. I do not know what could be the number of devices, what could be the size, whether will this such a small heat sink will do, I do not know, we need to find out. I have three legs are connected in this fashion. As of now, I have taken center point as a reference. It is not required for analysis. I have taken. The rule here is at any given time, one switch is on. At any given time, one switch is on in each leg. So that is the principle of operation in VSI. At any given time, one device is on. So in each leg, one device is on. So therefore, there are three devices on. I can have any combination, no issues. By the way, here S1 implies a control switch. In addition, there is a diode across it, because this switch should be able to carry current in both direction, but then voltage in only one direction. It need not block the voltage into this. So I need to have three phase supply. I will turn on S1, after 120 degrees I will turn on S3, and after 120 degree S5, and when S1 is on, VA0 is VDC by 2, when S3 is on, it is VB0 is VDC by 2, and when S5 is on, VC0 is VDC by 2. Similarly, the complementary switch is on, voltage is minus VDC by 2. Here are the waveforms, VA0 is the square of VB0, each of magnitude VDC by 2 and VC0. though B C 0, S, see here, do not get confused here. S 5 is turned on after 240 degrees, okay, because after 120 S 3 and after 120 S 5, and that will remain on for 180, okay. So, compared to the positive 0 crossing of S 1, this turns on after 240 and it is allowed to remain there for 180. So, 240 plus 180 is how much? 240 plus 180, that completes one cycle, but and 60 degrees still remaining. So, this is 60 degrees where S 5 is turns off and S 2 is turned on. So, this is one complete cycle, each of 60 degrees, pi by 3, 2 pi by 3 and pi. So, 0 to pi by 3. See here, at any given time, 3 devices are on. 1, 6 is on in the lower half, and S 5 upper device in C phase. What is V A 0? See, this voltage, when the switches are on, see, switches are on in a voltage source inverter, the so called pole voltages are known. Pole voltage means voltage of A or B or C with respect to either the midpoint of the DC link or with respect to the negative DC link, it is known. I told, let me repeat, if the devices are, if I know the conducting state of the device, if I know the conducting state of the device, I know the pole voltages. Pole voltage is nothing but voltage of A or B or C with respect to the negative of the DC link or center point of the DC link. So, had plotted the pole voltages. Now, how do I determine the line voltage? Line voltage is nothing but VAB. VAB is VA0 minus VB0. VA0 minus VB0. VA0 is VDC by 2, VB0 is minus VDC by 2. So, VA0 minus VB0 is VDC. So, for 2 pi by 3 radians, VA0 is a square wave of magnitude VDC. From 2 pi by 3 to pi, VA0 is also positive, VB0 is also positive. So, VA0 minus VB0 is 0. So, there is a 0 voltage period in line to line voltage waveform, and similarly, in the negative half. So, line to line voltage waveform, I have pulse width of 120 degrees, the magnitude is VDC and 0 for 60 degrees. Now, if I know the voltage waveform, depending upon the type of load, I can draw the current waveform, no issues. If the now I have a 3 phase inverter, the load could be either delta connected or star connected. Now, star connected, if it is a star connected node, I need to know the phase voltage, okay. If it is a delta connected load, I can determine the phase current if I know the phase voltage. So, I will repeat, if I, you know, if the load is delta connected, if I know the voltage waveform, line to line voltage waveform, and if I know the type of load, it is possible to determine or it is possible to draw the load current waveform, I mean the phase current waveform, phase current, not the line current. If I know two phase currents, I need to add them, okay, waveforms I need to add to get the line waveform. Please do not say that root phase current into root 3 is line current. No, it is not valid, okay. So, that is how it looks. A constant voltage is being applied to VAB, depending upon the type of load, current waveform will change. If it is a RL load, voltage applied is constant DC, so current will exponentially increase at steady state. Okay. If it starts from at t is equal to 0, if I energize, current has to start from 0. At steady state, it has a negative value, exponentially increase. Voltage applied to the load is 0. If the voltage applied to the load is 0 and if the load is RL, current will decay. Because applied voltage is 0, if the load is purely inductor, this will be linear. In this zone, current will remain constant because voltage applied to the inductor is 0, so current will remain constant and here current will decay. So, this is the current waveform IAB. I can draw similarly IAC. IA I can determine by adding these two waveforms. I have to add these two waveforms to get IA. This is how it looks. I will not discuss much time on this. So, the observations, there are 6 steps in each cycle. The number of steps in each cycle are 6, hence the name 6 step inverter. VS0, VB0, VC0 are pole voltages. Okay. Predominant harmonic, what is the predominant harmonic in the pole voltages? So, it is a square wave, definitely all odd harmonic 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, everything. But then line to line voltage is a square wave of 120 degrees duration. Okay. It can be proved that harmonic only 6n plus or minus 1 harmonics will be present, 5, 7, 11, 13, so on. Okay. One way is to write the Fourier series or write the Fourier series for VS0, we all know that this 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, everything is there. Here also 1, 3, 5, 7, 11 harmonics. Now VAB is VA0 minus VB0, add them, you get the harmonic spectrum. Third harmonic and third harmonic get cancelled. Okay. It can be proved, you just prove it. So, in the line to line voltage waveform, you cannot have third harmonic. That is a very popular, a very important result that we have studied. So, predominant harmonic is 5th, 7th, 11th, 13th, 6 and 1 plus or minus 1. Okay. So this is the VS0, this is the VB0 harmonic spectrum. Okay. This you can get by writing VB0 and subtracting. So, the RMS value of the line to line voltage is, okay, square root of 2 by 3 into VDC. What is the RMS value of this? It will get as 2 by 3 into VDC, okay, of this waveform. And the fundamental component here is root 6 by pi into VDC, 0.78 VDC. Fundamental is 0.78 VDC, RMS value of the line to line, RMS value of the line to line voltage is 816 VDC. For star connected load, I need to determine the phase voltage. There are two ways to do it. Okay. One is depending upon the switching combination, draw the equivalent circuit and determine what is VAN, what is VBN, VCN. I mean, it is something like this. Say SCA, at any given time, 3 devices are on. SCA is on. This is on, lower switch of SB and lower switch of SC is on. I will take this example. See, at any given time, one of them is on. I will take SCA is on, lower of SB, lower of SC is on. So, when SCA is on, what could be the equivalent circuit? What could be the equivalent circuit? When SCA is on, A gets connected to the positive DC bus. When the lower switch is on, B gets connected to the negative DC bus. Similarly, I have assumed that lower switch is on, C gets connected to the negative DC bus. So, how does the equivalent circuit look like? It looks something like this. See, I am not going to explain to you each and every step. One is on, so this is A, this is B, this is C finally connected to positive, negative, this is VDC, okay. Assuming the load to be balanced, okay. So what will happen? I have the magnitude of and the phase angle of the load impedance is the same. So I can prove that VAN is 2 by 3 VDC, VBN minus is equal to VCN is equal to minus 1/3 VDC. If say assume that this is R, so combine this, this is going to be R by 2, this is R, so voltage at this point comes to be 1/3, this comes to be 2/3. So can I make a generalized rule? I am not going to derive for other combinations. See, I have 3 switches, they can take 2 values, basically there are 8 possibilities, 8 possibilities, they are nothing, they are all 3 of them are on and all 3 of them are off, okay, those are 2 possibilities. Under that condition, when all 3 of them are on, A gets B and C, they get connected to the positive DC bus. So all 3 line terminals are at the same potential, so therefore source does not supply any power to the load. It is also known as load is freewheeling through the positive DC bus. Similarly, when the lower switches are on, these 3 points are connected to the negative DC bus. Power supplied by the source is 0, load freewheels through to the negative DC bus, okay. So when A, B and C are at the same point, VAB line to line voltage, VAB is 0, VBC is 0, VCA is also 0, all 3 line to line voltages are 0, AB, BC, CA, and therefore you can prove that VAN is also 0, VBN is also 0, VCN is also 0. So this is also known as, these 2 vectors also known as 0 voltage vectors, 0 voltage vectors. Why? Magnitude of the voltage applied is 0, all 3 terminals are either they are connected to the positive DC bus or they are connected to the negative DC bus. The remaining 6, what are they? 1 is on top, 2 are on in the bottom, or 2 are on in the top, 1 in the bottom, okay. So there are 6 such possibilities, 6 such possibilities, okay. So one such possibility is, I said I assumed A is upper device, A is on and lower switches of B and C are on, and what is the magnitude of the voltage that is obtained? If one device is on, we found that this voltage is 2 by 3, and when 2 devices are on, we found that this magnitude is 1/3. Remember, if one device is on, magnitude is 2 by 3, and if 2 devices are on, magnitude is 1/3. What is the sign? They could be either positive or negative. If only one upper switch is on, the corresponding phase voltage is positive. Similarly, if one lower device is on, okay, the magnitude is minus, sorry, the magnitude is 2 by 3 and sign is negative. Instead, 2 upper devices are on, magnitude is 1/3, sign is positive. Here, if the 2 devices are on, magnitude is 1/3, sign is negative. That's all. VBN and VCN are minus 1/3 VDC. Why? These 2 devices are on. VAN is 1/3. Sorry, VAN is 2/3 VDC plus. So there are 6 active states and 2 null states. So I can draw VAN VBN and VCN. Okay. How does the waveform look like? How does the waveform look like? See, I will go back. You can draw it from here also. In this zone, see here, VA0 is positive, VC0 is positive, but VB0 is negative. So, therefore, VAN is plus one third, plus one third. Why? Upper two devices are on and VA is also positive, so plus one third, whereas VBN is minus two third. Now, what happens from pi by 3 to 2 pi by 3? Only one switch S1 is on, B in the second leg S6 is on, that is a lower device, and in the third leg S2, which is again a lower device. There are two lower devices in the lower half are on. So, therefore, VBN and VCN are minus one third each and only one upper switch is on. So, therefore, VAN is two third VDC. See, in this zone, A and B, there are two devices are on. So, VAN is plus one third VDC. You can draw the equivalent circuit and derive. So, the phase voltage waveform here is one third VDC between 0 to pi by 3, pi by 3 to 2 pi by 3 is 2 by 3 VDC, and 2 pi by 3 to pi, it is again one third VDC. So, again there are 6 steps, hence the name 6 step inverter. Okay. See, the entire analysis is there, you can go back and read, it is simple. One is 0 vector vectors, this equivalent circuit approach, this is how the waveform look like, one third VDC, two third VDC, one third VDC, hence the name 6 steps. The harmonic spectrum, you can prove that. Okay. I'll just show you. The harmonic spectrum must be, yeah, again the phase voltage has 6 and plus or minus 1 harmonic, it can be proved. Okay. So, as of now we learnt how to convert DC to a higher voltage DC. Okay. Any voltage magnitude that I can get now, if I want to have a very high voltage, I need to use a transformer in the sense, and depending upon the power rating, I can choose either a flyback forward or a push pull, and there are other topologies also exist. Now, given an AC voltage, I can convert to AC. The output voltage waveform is a square wave. Okay. If it is a, the line to line voltage has 120 degree duration whose magnitude is VDC, for 60 degrees it is 0. Okay. Phase voltage waveform is one third VDC and two third VDC. The harmonic spectrum is approximately the same, 6n plus or minus 1 harmonics are there. So, we are using it as a UPS here to feed, assuming that, see, now there are, you need to make two assumptions. What are they? I have solar panel power that is coming here. This is resistive DC. Okay. This is DC to AC. Okay. Now, I can, in the sense, depending, if I want to have a 50 hertz supply, 50 hertz supply, the predominant harmonic is 6n plus or minus 1 harmonics, nothing but 250 and 350, 550, and that is 11 and 13, 650 hertz. These are the predominant harmonics, assuming that you want a 50 hertz supply. If you want to have a variable frequency supply, then therefore, as the frequency of the fundamental changes, frequency of the predominant harmonic also changes. Okay. As of now, I'll assume that it is a 50 hertz supply. Okay. Predominant harmonic is 250 and 350. I don't think we can directly connect this inverter to the grid because harmonic magnitude of this fifth and harmonic is substantial. So the total harmonic distortion THD of the voltage waveform is very high. So your the entire black box may not be able to satisfy the given norms of IEEE and IEC. So you may not be able to connect it to the grid. So if I have to connect it to the grid, definitely I need to reduce the harmonic content. How do I reduce this harmonic content? Okay. That I will discuss in my next lecture. For another 10 minutes or so, I will take up the questions. I will encourage you to come on chat mode because it reduces the time. And so I can directly read the question, I will repeat it instead of going into each and every center and repeating the question. Please feel free.
Warangal, over to you.
Sir, the one leg of a three-phase inverter, both the switches are complementary. That means if the upper switch is on, then the lower switch should be off. And if the lower switch is off, then upper switch will be on. The module that you have given, where the three legs which you have shown, it is always that condition, or by any means we can switch off both the switch, the upper switch as well as the lower switch, so that you can do any other modifications. So I hope you follow my question, sir.
Now I do follow. In a voltage source inverter, each leg, the devices in each leg are complementary. If S1 is off, if S1 is on, S4 is off, or vice versa. They are complementary. They are complementary. Say that again.
No. Both the switches can be made off. Both the switches can be made off.
No problem. No, you can turn it off. What is going to happen? See, if both the switches are off and if there is some current flowing this side, yes, it can flow. Are you with me? Some current can flow provided there is some current coming from the load side. In fact, it happens here, isn't it here? See here. You turned off the switch here. S1 and you turned on S2. Assume that you don't turn on S2. What will happen? Whatever the current that was flowing through the inductor, okay, this was the direction of current, it will start flowing through D2, okay, and when this current becomes 0, conduction stops. Conduction stops. Are you with me? So if there is some current coming from the load side, yes, it can flow through the diode. Okay. If there is no current coming, that's it. Is that clear to you?
Yes, sir, clear, sir. Actually, why I was asking means, suppose if I want to go for other topologies, higher topologies, higher levels.
Higher levels also the principle is the same. In a three level inverter, two devices are on. There is a rule to be followed. Here, one device is on at any given time. If both the devices are off, there is no power flow. It's only one. If there is some current coming from the load side, it can come and charge the DC link. That's all. In fact, that is being used sometimes. Suppose it's like this. I have a voltage. A three-phase voltage source inverter. This is line A, this is B and C, and I connect a capacitor here. I will not give any pulses to the active switches. connected to AC supply, connected to AC supply, okay, I have an uncontrolled bridge charging the capacitor. I have an uncontrolled bridge charging the capacitor. So we will see sometime later, this is being used initially to charge the DC link capacitor in a voltage source inverter feeding power to the grid. Okay. Is that okay? If I don't switch on, I have an uncontrolled bridge, three phase uncontrolled bridge. So there is a question in the sense inverter, the question I'll read out, sir, you said we can apply inverter for supplying reactive power, whether it depends upon our load or on the inverter can directly supply Q. I have a three phase source supplying power to the load, okay. As of now, I'll assume that it is a linear load, power factor is less, not equal to 1, linear. After some time, we'll see it can, you can have a non-linear load as well, okay. So if, when I'm saying linear load, current drawn is sinusoidal. If the input is sinusoidal, current drawn will be sinusoidal, but then power factor is not equal to 1. Under this condition, your voltage source inverter, how you do not ask me right now, can supply this Q. Okay, here is, if the load is SL is power load plus or minus JQL, as of now I will assume that inductive load plus QL, this inverter can supply QL. This inverter can supply QL, and thus QL should be less than or equal to, I will repeat this, QL should be less than or equal to S inverter, kVA rating of the inverter. kVA rating of the inverter, okay. So Q supplied by the inverter is, could be as high as the kVA rating of the inverter. To do that, a small amount of delta P is required. The delta P is to account for losses in the inductor and the losses taking place in this inverter, because whenever I switch the device, there are losses, okay. The circuit theory based for this I will explain to you. Right now I proved that inverter can supply any Q. Q could be as high as its inverter, its kVA rating. To do that, it requires delta P. Suppose I do not have a load here, I have just three phase transmission line, and if it requires Q, yes, this inverter can supply Q. That Q is equal to or less than or equal to inverter, its inverter, its VA rating, and so, and this inverter will draw a small amount of delta P from the source. So question is, you don't need to have a load. Now load could be grid or load could be some whatever. The question is, what are the advantages of three phase inverter over single phase inverter? Now how do I answer? What is the advantage of single phase supply over a three phase supply? That's all. If you want a three phase inverter, three phase supply, you need to have a three phase inverter. And if you want to have a single phase supply, you need to have a single phase inverter. It's as simple as that. So when do I go for a three phase? For low power application, I use single phase supply. For as the power rating increases, I go in for a three phase supply. Go to the market and find out, can you get say more than 3 HP pump, irrigation pump, a single phase 3 HP irrigation pump? You may not get. So you have to go in for a three phase supply. So if you want a three, if you have a three phase load, I need to have a three phase supply. What are the reasons that makes electrolytic capacitor unreliable? come on, that is a device physics or whatever the capacitor construction or design aspect, you go and read the construction of a capacitor, why they fail, what is the reason that makes a electrolytic capacitor unreliable, okay. Yeah, how to generate a sine wave from the output from the inverter, don't worry, I will discuss right now. How to generate a sine wave from the inverter, I will discuss right now. Sir, out of two modes, namely 120 degree and 180 degree mode inverter, which is good for star and delta connected load? Let us not talk about 120 and 180 degree, this is just a basic block. If you have to sell your inverter in the international market or in the in market, neither your 120 degree will work, neither 120 nor 180 degree will work. You have to do something else. In the next class, we will discuss after this. Please, 120 and 180, they are simple to understand. Since they are simple to understand, I did this and I told you the limitations. Now we will discuss what are the limitations. I told you the harmonic content. So if it is a 50 hertz supply, I have a 250 hertz and 350 hertz harmonic. So you may not be able to connect your load. If you connect your load, there will be harmonic torques that will be generated, which I am not going to discuss. You may not be able to feed it to the grid either. So you have to do something else. What is that? We will see in my next lecture. What is the advantage of using split power supply in three phase inverter? Who is using the split power supply? I did tell you that you don't need to use center point of the DC link as a reference. In fact, it is not there. It is not available. I can use one single capacitor. It is just for convenience sake that I have used a center point. Of course, by the way, I do not know in what context you are asking this question. I can use this if I have a split capacitor topology, and if I connect the center point to the neutral of the source, there are certain advantages. Please, K, J, S, M, I do not know in what context are you using. You are in what context you ask this question. If your question is based on this slide, if your question is based on this slide, let me tell you one thing, you do not require this point at all, do not require this connection. In fact, in a conventional three phase voltage source inverter, this point is not available. But then there are certain topologies I can use this point, and if I connect it to the neutral, there are certain advantages. What are those advantages? I will discuss it. I hope you meant that. You can confirm through chat. Okay. Now 36. I'll take two more questions.
Sir, I was asking about the split power supply.
Where is the split power supply? Which slide are you talking about?
We asked the question about split power supply.
Where is the split power supply?
No, that you already answered, sir.
Okay, but no, I have not answered in the sense. Wait a minute. I have only one part here I have answered, assuming that the question is based on that photograph. But then there are circuit topologies wherein we connect the center point of the DC link to the neutral. When you do that, there are a lot of other advantages. What are they? We will see. Now, which question is that? Did you ask the first part or second part? Now, what is? Yeah. Chalo. Yeah, first part. First part you don't require. What are we doing still in DC to DC? Okay. How much efficient to apply a multi-level inverter rating? How much efficient to apply a multi-level inverter for obtaining a sine wave inverter? Now why multi-level inverter? We are still in two-level. We'll see multi-level sometime later. Multi-level generally used for hyper application. What are the advantages? We will see. First, we'll try to understand two-level or PWM technique, and we'll see three-level or multi-level later. For DC to DC conversion, how to select whether to go by buck boost, flyback? Tell us formula. Sir, I am not going to tell you the formula. for DC to DC conversion, how to select whether to go for buck boost, push pull, fly, kindly tell us formula related to converter selection. No sir, depending upon your power level, depending upon the input output voltages, you have to select one of them or you have to modify them. I do not want to tell you nor I will tell you which one you should use. You choose fine, you take one topology and if it is wrong, what price will you pay? Okay, fine, you will learn, no, you will gain some experience, that is more important. So, I am not going to tell you which one you should use, it depends on the power level as well as the input and output voltage ratios. Sir, suppose the inverter is connected to the grid, then on what basis we can select the coupling inductor value? Wait a minute, let us connect the, first we will connect the inverter to the grid and we will see later. We haven't connected the inverter to the grid so far. What could be the value of the TH in an ideal sine wave inverter? Hey Bhagwan, what should be the value of THD in an ideal sine wave? What do you mean by THD? THD is total harmonic distortion and you say in an ideal inverter, ideal sine wave. I think there is an inner contradiction, I guess. Total harmonic distortion and ideal sign. Anyway, wait a minute, this class, what is ASEB, the value of inductor, value of capacitor, we will see. Let us connect the inverter first to the grid, then we will find out what should be the value of L.